All right, welcome back to SF Vortex. We've made it down to the War Room, and joining me today is one of our War Room regulars, Mr. Mark Altman, editor-in-chief of Sci-Fi Universe Magazine, and Jeffrey Walker is here, founder of Jeffrey B. Walker Incorporated, a motion picture marketing company specializing in genre films and other niche products. Sure. And Dr. Jim Kirkland is here, senior paleontologist of the Dynamation International Society and the man who has discovered numerous species of dinosaurs, including the Utah Raptor. I thought that was a Toronto Raptor. No?
Okay. Utah.
All right.
Toronto's next.
First topic. It's topic number one. Here we go. This movie Lost World, already $170 million. Is it worthy of all the money, all the praise? Mr. Walker, start us off. What do you think?
Well, of course it is. This was a movie everybody in the world wanted to see.
Right.
And they saw it the first weekend it opened.
Is it the movie you were expecting?
Yes and no. I mean, it certainly had all the dinosaurs you could ask for. I think it had a little problems in the story department, but more than that, I thought it was a perfectly entertaining way to spend 2 hours.
Mr. Altman, I know you loved it, and you thought it was terrific, right?
No, I wouldn't go that far. In fact, I wouldn't use terrific anywhere near this particular motion picture.
Okay.
I think that, unfortunately, it's a film that has a terrible story. I think, you know, the dinosaurs look wonderful, I mean, no question about that, but ultimately it's not about anything. It's a series of set pieces that are strung together that don't amount to anything. And in the final conclusion, which is something I think we're all very excited about, seeing San Diego trampled by dinosaurs, it turns into slapstick. It's like a John Landis movie. Oh. I mean, it's the Blues Brothers. You spend 2 hours trying to convince people dinosaurs are real, only to turn it into slapstick. Doesn't work for
Let's go to our resident expert, Mr. Kirkland. Your thoughts on Lost World?
Well, there's not many movies that get scientists the world over waiting for years for them to come out, eagerly anticipating them. Mm-hmm. Paleontologists love it. They're seeing it over and over.
Really?
Far superior to Jurassic Park.
Right.
The kids lining up to see our expeditions all up because of the movie.
Uh-huh.
For us, it's a hit.
Well, I have to be honest, I was a little disappointed. We talked about that earlier. I was a little disappointed in the movie, and evidently I wasn't the only one.
No.
Some of our viewers, let's check out a letter. Our Vortex fans, Ardell and Jeff Lawson, wonder, has Spielberg forgotten how to make a movie? The Lost World was a disjointed mess, but our 7-year-old loved it. Which is a very good point, because I was a little skeptical about bringing my 8-year-old Brandon to this movie. Is this movie for kids, Mr. Walker?
Oh, I think so. I took my kids to it. They were 11 and 12. They both loved it. They don't bring the same sort of baggage an adult audience brings to this kind of movie, and it sort of reminded me of the experience I had when I was a kid going to Saturday morning.
Kids are the only ones who are stupid enough to think this is a good movie. I mean, it's for kids. That's who you bring to a movie like this. And they go, look, Dad, it's a dinosaur. They don't think the story doesn't make sense. Julianne Moore doesn't act like a scientist. Yeah. I mean, this guy, he at least looks like Indiana Jones. I believe he got skeletons. He looks like a paleontologist. Julianne Moore, I mean, she couldn't even get the species out of her mouth without making you laugh. And, you know, Jeff Goldblum has a few funny one-liners, but, you know, where's the movie?
Mr. Kirkland, do you agree with the very shy Mr. Altman here?
Yes. The 7-year-olds loved it. My 7-year-old loved the movie. She also liked Mars Attacks. But the 2 and 3-year-olds...
There goes her credibility.
The 2 and 3-year-olds up in front, they were having their problems with it. And there were a lot of 2 and 3-year-olds brought in, and certainly people were bringing in little kids, dinosaurs, little kids. They're cute. We love them. It's not a movie for little kids, but 7-year-olds could really enjoy it.
Here's something that I found very interesting from David Cope.
David Kep.
Kep, that's what I meant to say.
Good.
David
Close personal friend.
L.A. Tahoe, he's terrific, by the way. Anyway, listen to his letter, okay? I was quoted referring to the films Jurassic Park and The Lost World, for which I wrote the screenplays, as two of the best movies ever made. What I actually said was I thought they were two of the best B movies ever made. I am proud of the movies, but I'm not deluded. Is this guy trying to separate himself from a movie with
I think he's trying. I think he's trying to get committed. I think. I mean, anyone who would say that these are two of the finest movies, B movies. I mean, maybe finest D movies of all time. I mean, it's certainly the among the worst of Spielberg's OWA. I mean, this is a guy who's made Jaws, who's made Raiders of the Lost Ark. I mean, this is right down there with Hook. So, I mean,
first of all science fiction genre films were B movies before the 60s when a couple of A movie science fiction films came into the picture. Mm-hmm. These big summer blockbusters by nature are B movies. They're supposed to be nothing more than a few hours of good time at the movie theater. And that's what they were setting out to do.
It's a roller coaster ride.
Basically,
you're shooting down the roller coaster. You don't want to see the bends before they get you. The bigger the bends, they flip you over when you're not expecting it. But one after another, hit you hard, hit you fast, hit you with the unexpected. And, you know, that's what they were trying to do. And I think most of us were pretty surprised.
Right. I got to disagree.
You're agreeing with Jeff.
I got to disagree. I think this is part of the systematic reduction of standards that's going on when it comes to the genre. People say it's only a science fiction movie. Did it entertain us? $7, things blow up. We saw dinosaurs. But where are the stories? Where are the films in the late 70s, which not only entertained us, but were, you know, good dialogue, compelling characters, three-dimensional characters. Now if we go in and we're entertained, we say it was worth the $7. But I think we need to have higher standards than that. You know, where the summer of 1982, I think back to, had Blade Runner, we had Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, John Carpenter's The Thing. I mean, the list goes on. I mean, and these were movies that had it all.
Two of them were bombs, by the way.
That's true, you know, but I'm not looking at it from a financial perspective.
Hey, if people are
artistic.
if people are buying Dennis Rodman as an actor, I think they'll buy anything. I got to take a break. There's lots more here, folks. When we come back, we will hunt the wily Hyposaurus. Don't go anywhere. We're right back. All right, welcome back to the show that Tyra Banks has never, ever missed. We're SF Vortex, and we are still in the war room with Sci-Fi Universe editor Mark Altman, real-life paleontologist Dr. James Kirkland, and marketing wizard Jeffrey Walker. And we're debating Spielberg's latest, The Lost World. Okay, guys, let's get to another viewer letter. They're always terrific. And here, L.J. Ray writes, I thought there were too many sickening death scenes. We all know dinosaurs can eat people, and why were the dinosaurs always hungry? I would think that even T-Rexes would get full every once in a while. James, how about it? Do you think the T-Rexes and other dinosaurs, was it accurate? Hey,
well, you know, it's another chance for Hollywood to have an opportunity for some full frontal human consumption.
Yes.
But T-Rexes were probably spitting us out. They were pretty mad. But if you look at a T-Rex, this is a tooth of a T-Rex.
That's one tooth.
It's like a steam shovel.
Wow.
And they'd bolt down a couple hundred pounds of meat at a time, so each one of us is a bite. A little appetizer for the main course.
I don't understand.
Unless, of course, it was Roseanne or someone like that. It'd be a whole meal.
I don't understand the point of complaining about dinosaur violence. This is not imitatable. You know, you're not going to breed a dinosaur that's going to start eating little kids. I mean, this is harmless. As harmless as violence can be, this is harmless violence. I mean, as opposed to, you know, people going out and shooting each other in some of these action movies where, you know, people getting shot in car accidents and killing and stabbing. I mean, you know, it's people getting eaten. I mean, we loved that when we were kids,
sure.
I'm sure.
And, you know, very few
Godzilla.
Kids grow up to eat people.
A couple of bad apples ruined for the rest of us.
And the great white shark in Jaws had a much bigger appetite.
Bruce was much, hey, there was no Happy Meal or any time.
How important is it to be accurate, James?
Well, for myself, it's reasonably important. Yeah, I spend about half of my question and answer periods every time I lecture, and I lecture all over the country, answering questions about Jurassic Park and correcting the errors in Jurassic Park.
Mm-hmm.
I have to admit, I'm thrilled that Lost World does not look like it's going to add to the number of questions I have to correct. In fact, they went out of their way to correct it with the sense of smell of T-Rex. T-Rex is a walking nose. Here's T-Rex. That's its nose. Its area of its sense of smell is as big as the rest of the
right.
brain.
It's a walking nose, but Julianne Moore didn't notice, and Super Safari Guy Pete Potwist whistle didn't
Super Safari Guy
didn't realize fossil weight. Thank you very much, right. Jeff. David Kep. So the thing is, they don't notice. He even goes up and says, oh, what is that on your, are you bleeding? She says, no, it's dinosaur blood. Oh, okay.
My blood,
and then they walk around.
Jacket.
And then 5 minutes later, you got the T-Rex, you know, munching on Jeff Goldblum. Oh, you know, I smell something.
What are we going to react the scene? Look at that.
I'm showing you how Lost World should have transpired. had I done it, it would have been a lot more, never mind.
Jim, how has Lost World educated us or misled us about dinosaurs?
Lost World, I think, is kind of neutral. Jurassic Park seriously misled us.
Give me one example.
They based the Velociraptor on this animal. This is the claw, the biggest claw ever found up at that point. Then we were lucky enough to find this claw, basically vindicating Steven Spielberg's two big raptors. This is the Utah Raptor. But also with things like this. This is the head of a thing called Troodon, it's the smartest of all the dinosaurs. Mm-hmm. They had books that came out tied to it, the real dinosaurs of Jurassic Park. Okay. They're smart as chimpanzees. Oh. Well, here's its brain, certainly not as smart as a chimpanzee.
Now, what about this? I found this at Simi Valley. Toys R Us.
Jeff, well, certainly.
Jeff, what about the website? Some call it a stunt recently when Universal's website for Lost World, instead of the dinosaur, we had ourselves a duck. Mm. And some people said it was some hacker up to some tricks. Other people said it was Universal looking for more publicity. Personally, I think they needed more publicity, like the WB needs another bad sitcom. What's your take on this?
I don't believe for a second that the studio knew about it officially. It's okay. Totally possible someone who worked on the site and knew how to get into it did it.
Right.
But I don't believe it was officially sanctioned or that someone sat down and thought up some prank to get more publicity.
Mark, what's your take on that?
Well, it wasn't very clever. Jurassic Duck? Mm-hmm. I mean, well, you know.
It wasn't very.
I mean, if you're going to go through the trouble of breaking into the computer, at least put some money in your bank account, change your grades. Jurassic Duck? I mean, you know, War Games, it ain't.
Right. Jim, what about paleontologists? Were they, how were they portrayed in the movie? Were you happy with the way they did that?
I was moderately happy. In the original movie, they weren't very excitable. We were passionate about what we do. Mm-hmm. This movie, you know, they're kind of walking around going, oh boy, this is a dinosaur walking around. Mm-hmm. Any of us would be so floored, we'd just be, our adrenaline levels would be so high you wouldn't get us to shut up.
Well, I'll tell you, I think we saw a little too much of the T-Rex. The Velociraptors, I think in both movies, were very interesting creations, and they really established a backstory for them. But we'd seen the T-Rex in the first movie, and then to have in the second movie, and then to have big gaping plot holes, like the T-Rex destroying everyone on the ship when it apparently is locked in cold storage. You know, strains credibility. But I definitely would like to see them take a third attempt at this because it's a fascinating premise. And if done well, it could be a wonderful motion picture.
Certainly, the dinosaurs were vastly improved over the first movie.
All right.
But if we want to talk about the laws of physics, that's a whole different story.
And we will talk about that next time you guys come. Can you join me again sometime too? Okay. That's all the time we have for In the War Room, folks. I want to thank my guests, Mark Altman, Jeffrey Walker, and Dr. Jim Kirkland. SF Vortex will be right back, so don't go anywhere.